So due diligence documents. Now, in software companies, these are really the checklist, I think, on a high level of what documents you're looking for. Now, the first thing I always start with, if I am assisting a company buy a software company, is, okay, well, we know their software, and we know someone built the software. They're developers, they're employees that might be developers, there might be outsourced companies that are developers, there might be engineers who are working on database designs, algorithms, and then there might also be underlying software technologies or components that are owned by other people. The first thing I'm going to do is say, okay, look, I need you, target company, to start bundling and making available for review, which is often done electronically now. And usually, we used to use the phrase data room often for very small cap applications. Guess what? It's Google Drive or Dropbox, which, you know, is a little bit loosey-goosey, but people do it. Long story short, you should be able to see that every, you know, Susie, Tom, Dick, and Harry who were engaged or worked for the target company in some way developing IP have been covered with the particular type of agreement that speaks to them. So you'll see, for example, I have first bullet point, employment and independent contractor agreements. If there's a third party developer that's a studio that makes software, were they engaged with regard to what they were doing with a contract that makes clear that what they developed is owned line for line, code base for code base, by your target company? That's a class of relationship. Work for hire agreements generally speak to the same thing, but that may not be a developer. That might be even just somebody who one-off did some little bit of work that became incorporated into the overall software. Very important. And were there non-disclosure agreements? In other words, if trade secret is a concern, and just as a quick overview, trade secret is essentially something that is protectable because everyone agreed, mostly by contract and practice, not to disclose it. And in software, sometimes that's very important. The secret sauce of how software may work is not necessarily something that could be copyrighted or should be copyrighted. And hence, NDAs become a very integral part of the documentation chain. Shareholder agreements and stock purchase agreements, I'll get into that more. But that's really about the investor relationship. So going back into what's the first thing Kaiser would do? Okay, well, the easiest thing to start with are developers, employees, labor generally that have produced things for the company. And that's also a function of what type of company it is. In the app world, there might be a couple of in-house founder developers who work, and then likely there is an outsourced company somewhere else in the world that was also producing content, and likely there is some kind of technology that they may be licensing from a third party or is open source. We'll talk more about that. Again, the next thing I'd say is that if the brand value of the company is important, you really need to see what its trademark situation is. Did they register trademarks? Have they protected trademarks? Do they have a brand that's infringing? Interesting enough, I find in software the brand value is much more important than it used to be. It used to be that you just buy the technology and be done with it, but a lot of it now is trying to maintain the integrity of the acquired party because they have a marketplace relationship, even if it's B2B as opposed to B2C, with their clientele that's powered by the brand. And whether or not you're going to maintain the original entity or not, if you say, for example, I want to buy the assets, I don't want your entity, how do you buy the trademark if it hasn't been registered? It becomes a much harder thing. So that's very important. Now, another very important thing that I would look at and I would ask is, okay, software company, you have a technology, that's great. Would you say, and you have to ask this question 600 ways as if it was a deposition, that your technology is fully proprietary and in-house, meaning there is no third party that has contributed to the overall technology in some way? Or would you say that you have licenses with other parties? Because getting that out of a small or mid-cap acquisition late can transform the entire portrait. You might find out that you're in a lot of trouble because there are a bunch of licenses to third-party products or technologies that aren't there.